They're holding in her hand and saying, you are not like that. You are not so strong. Others may do it. I don't know whether they have insulation and immunity for that. But for you, the hand of a woman in your hand sends communication to your head. Suddenly you just know that something is communicating here. What do you do? There's nothing wrong. That's why your pocket is good here. Eh? Do you know that the pocket on your trouser, what is it meant for? Eh? What should you do?
No holding up.
It's not compulsory to shake hands.
It's not compulsory.
Is it compulsory to shake hands?
No.
No. Your hand is in your pocket. All this. Oh, sister, God bless you. That's no problem. Because you know that your hand has brought you into trouble before. Keep your hand. The Bible was saying, lift up your drooping hands. Strengthen your weak knees. You must be very conscious as to deal with your areas of vulnerabilities. Don't lock the door. Say you are canceling a woman. Canceling may move to another level. You will not know that you are the one who opened the door for the devil. You know that you have challenge with money. Don't make yourself an unnecessary treasurer. When they are bringing money, say, take the money there. Take the money there. Say, pastor, just hold it for us for 1 week. Say, no. I don't hold money. I don't hold money. Because money will hold me. You know yourself. When the Bible says, lift up your drooping hands, strengthen your weak knees, that's very critical.
Your weak knees.
Those areas where you see yourself like this, strengthen it.
Amen.
Don't joke with it. Make straight paths for your feet so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. God does not want you to fall. He wants you to be healed. So walk straight. Don't take corner. We are all here, we are ministers. But not everyone is going where you are going. There are some people here, I'm sorry, we don't know why they are in the ministry. They are there, but we don't know how they came in. And if you move too close to them, they will quench your fire. These are fire extinguishers. I'm sorry. You spent 1 hour with them, all the desire to serve God sincerely with them. You say, well, what are you talking about? I've been in this ministry for 15 years before you came. Eh? You have to plan. And you see how they are not saying, they'll give somebody 5,000 CD. What is 5,000? How can you live on 5,000? Eh? You have to do something. That's the kind of man that will call you aside and pump his own evil cancer in your heart and quench your fire. It's not every man you must move with.
I hear you.
Are you hearing me?
I hear you.
Look for those who are passionate.
Amen.
Those when you pray with them for 1 hour, you are on fire again.
Yes.
Don't go and see with someone that when you go there, you see my presbytery. We need to move. The fire must go. These people must repent. I'm going to reach out to you. He said, Cool down. Presbyterian church has been there before you are there. And it will still be there when you are there. Don't kill yourself for nothing. I hope I'm not offending you.
What I mean.
Put away from you crooked speech. Put devious talk far from you. Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flows the springs of life. Let your eyes look directly forward. It is where you are going that you look at. Don't be doing like this. If you want to win your race, look straight ahead. Your gaze be straight before you. Ponder the path of your feet. Then all your ways will be sure. Don't swerve to the right or to the left. Turn your foot away from evil. When you have time, take time to study those bullet points one by one. God will give you victory. Fight! Everybody say fight.
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 Fight. Fight.
Yes. That's the instruction. Fight the good fight of faith. You see, you know the word to fight is aggressive. In fact, when we use the word fight, it means initiate it. Is that all right? Initiate it. If you don't initiate, I have watched football players. I found that there are sometimes that a team will concentrate on their goalpost. Eh? They are heavily defending, but they don't have strikers. They don't have attackers. They always win. You know why? Because everything is concentrated here. The attackers are coming from the other side. By the time they are attacking you for continuous 30 minutes, one of these times, even because you are too many struggling, you will hit one another and almost give a long goal.
Go.
Am I right? It's not strategic to only be defensive. You must become offensive to drive away. You know that if they're attacking you, and one of your people carry the ball and he's running. What will happen to all of them? They start running back. That's the way to deliver yourself from heavy opposition. Fight! But don't fight useless battles. Fight a good fight of faith. Please read it at your own time. God will help us.
Amen.
Fighting actually is also my defense and protection. As I fight, I set the enemy to flight. He retreats and runs away to protect whatever remains on his side before I come to ravage him. I must fight the good fight of faith to also spoil Satan and his kingdom. It is not enough for me to keep at peace. He is not keeping the peace. Is Satan keeping the peace?
No.
He's not. He's seeking every time how to break the fence and creep into my own vineyard with tender grapes. He comes in like the little fox that spoils the vine. I must fight the good fight of faith. I must fight with deliberateness. It is not accidental fights that I'm talking about. And that God is calling you to do henceforth. It is a deliberate, conscious, contentious fight for the faith. May God help us.
Amen.
Sir, overcoming ministerial challenges requires an aggressive, proactive fight. Deliberate. If you are deliberately fighting, you also see that the devil will leave you alone. Then he will begin to protect his territory. He said, well, if I can't catch him, let him not catch all that I've gathered. That is why wearing the gospel as a shoe was one of the weapons of our warfare.
Yeah.
Have you noticed that?
Mm.
Because once you are ready to go and announce good news, you are going to the gates of the enemy. Don't let the devil always concentrate on your own gates. Did you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
If you are not aggressively going out to rescue souls from the kingdom of darkness, you are only inviting the devil to come and be, you know, selling something at your gate. And did you see these brothers who are selling something? Where are they? that are our gate. And they are very deliberate. As you are coming out, whatever God told you here, whatever prayer you wanted to pray, if you didn't finish your prayers, I'm going. You are joking. Because as you meet them there, they'll start confronting you with everything. Clear your gates. Don't put the devil at your gates. The Bible did not say, I will be my church. And the devil will be fighting at his gate. What did God say? I will build my church and the gates of hell. So where should our battle be? It's there, not here. There. If you don't take the path to the gate of the enemy, you are already planning to lose. Please tell somebody by your side. Fight.
Fight.
Be deliberate about it.
Be deliberate about it.
Initiate it.
Initiate it.
Pursue it.
Pursue it.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Take hold of the eternal life to which you are called. Pastors, may I tell you, if you cannot save people, make sure you are not lost. Are you hearing me? If you cannot help others to go to heaven,
why would you?
Make sure you are not lost. Whenever I enter into the aircraft,
just save yourself.
And you know what the air hostess normally say? They said, in case of loss of pressure, oxygen, something will drop on the panel above your head. Feed your own first before you do what? What do they say like that? Even your baby. You can't take care of your baby first until you are sure you are safe. An unsafe man cannot save another person. No matter what, take hold the eternal life to which you are called. Before you became a preacher, you are first of all called to eternal life. Am I right?
Yes.
To be a minister is secondary to your salvation. Lay hold of the eternal life to which you are called. And about which you made the good confession in the presence of the presbyter. Did you hear me? The day you are being ordained, even though you have been church for many years, the presbyters, the elders, they still ask you to tell them the story of when you became born again. You remember that?
Yeah.
They ask you, when were you baptized to be a full believer? Did you remember that story?
Mm-hmm.
And then they ask you, tell us, how did you know you were called to the ministry? Were those questions they ask? You were first called to this eternal life. That's the first thing you must keep on. Keep, fight to keep it and possess it. The resurrection life, the Christ life to which you have been called, that's what you confess that has happened to you before we can make you a preacher that you are now. Don't lose it. Don't let it slip out of your hand. Where will you put your face to have lost so great a life that has brought deliverance and release to many lives? Make sure you don't lose your hope. May God help us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Finally, keep the commandment, the word of God, unstained and free from reproach. That's what 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 13 began to say. Please, keep the word of God uncontaminated. I don't know how to express that in a short moment, but I'd like to tell you that the word of God is a treasure. It is God's comprehensive equipment for preparing men for glory. We are stewards of this mystery, and it is required in stewards that they should be found faithful. You are custodian of the word of God. Your ordination is to teach and uphold the doctrines of the church. Can I beg you, keep the commandment unstained. Don't allow it to be spotted. Don't allow people to ridicule the word of God because you are not handling it well. If I must remain a custodian of the word and a preacher of it, my life must keep it unstained and stainless. My conduct must make the word free from reproach. When I do not live according to the word of God, men will speak. They will not speak directly against me. It is the word of God they will discredit as if it has failed. O thou man of God, there is need to walk consciously of this charge day by day. You must joyfully and obediently bring honor to the Lord's name and to the word of God. May you not in any way, by life, by conduct, by any association, whatever, discredit the word of God. And how long will you do this? I must do this until it is appearing in glory. This I cannot do just for a while. It is until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. I cannot take a leave from this lifestyle and do something else or something contrary. I have been publicly identified with this world, and my obedience has gone abroad. So I have no other way to live than to press on with this right life, that we only adorn the word of God and lift it up before the eyes of men everywhere as irreproachable, undefiled, and unsustained. The last injunction there, which I will just read, guard the deposit entrusted to him. That's what you find in verse 20 of that chapter. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 20. Guard the deposit entrusted to you. O Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you. Avoid irreverent babble and contradiction of what is falsely called knowledge. For by professing it, some are swear from the faith. Grace be with you. There is indeed a deposit of grace entrusted to you as you came into the ministry. There is the word of grace entrusted to you by his mercy. I must guard it jealously and carefully. I must not be careless at this time. The truth the Lord has revealed to me graciously must not be handled with levity. I must avoid irreverent babble, contradiction of what is falsely referred to as knowledge, empty talk. And you know, many of us who are theologians, sometimes you are unnecessarily lured to liberalism. You think it is knowledge to criticize Jesus. You think it is a scholarship, that you are being scholastic to tear the Bible down as if it is not the inspired word of God. And you are boasting because you are collaborating with some liberal theologians whose life are scattered, whose marriage you don't know where they are. These are people that are godless, who sneak into our midst. They don't adorn the word of God. They trample upon it. They think it is lack of scholarship when you are writing academic paper to quote the Bible. They prefer you are quoting human beings. You never thought that Jesus and his word and all that God has said is the authentic reference that you must refer to for all your submission.
Hallelujah.
This kind of scholarship is wicked. You can never see Islam doing that to their Quran. We thought that we are something. We have scattered our own scripture. We have made our own theology porous, diluted. Anybody, any bloody man will come in And then he, in fact, is querying the authorship of, I said, what was your business about that? Who told you that we are here studying authors? We are studying God's word. It doesn't matter who God used to pass to bring his word to us. What matters is what has God said. And the word of God is not just geographical. Some standards say, according to Paul, when he was reacting to the problem of the Corinthians, so he said this is his own opinion. I said, no. Every scripture is inspired by God and is useful for training, for teaching, for correction, for doctrine. Every scripture, not some part of it. Please uphold the word of God. The grace that God has deposited to you, guard it. Don't let anybody discredit it in your hand. I must be focused on the truth of the gospel. I must preach it with all my strength. The opportunity I have to preach is not to be squandered on anything else. May I beg you, the pulpit, are you hearing me? The pulpit is first and foremost a platform to do what? To speak, teach, and bring meaning to the word of God. That's the purpose of pulpit. The first time they erected pulpit, that was what they erected it for. It's not for political announcement. While you can speak about what people should do in politics, this pulpit is not constructed for political campaign. Don't allow careless people to be coming here and be speaking anything they like. The pulpit is meant to declare the sacred word of God. Can I beg you, protect our pulpit? Protect it. Before anybody climbs to that pulpit, check him out. That's why we have the vestry, isn't it? Whenever I was invited to preach in any Presbyterian congregation, you pass through the vestry. You don't come like this. You come from behind. And the elders, they have met with you. I went to preach in one church. Even though I was a preacher of many years, you know the question they asked me? They said, Brother Billy, we thank you for coming. But can you please tell us your testimony? How did you give your life to Jesus? I said, yes. That's a church where they don't fear anybody. That's a church you don't bamboozle them with your charisma. They want to get fat and figure. Are you a child of God? And I had to humble myself to tell them the story of how I became born again. They said, okay. So what of your family life? I hope you are still a husband and one wife. I said, yes. But these are things that you are beginning to drop. You are waving it. You are not insisting anymore. Please, sir, I beg you, guard what God has entrusted to you.
Don't just come on the preaching plan.
Please avoid godless, foolish discussion with those who oppose you with their so-called knowledge. To guard the treasure I have been given, I must do so with my life. I must spend and be spent in keeping this treasure till it is appearing. I must avoid the talk show religion.
Hallelujah.
And the talk practice show. Confusion of the so-called experts. Those who are caught up in a lot of talk can miss the whole point of our faith. May the Lord help you. Now I would like to request you to pause at this point and to pray. Thou man and woman of God, I have put up a short prayer. Even though I don't want you to repeat it, but I want us to read it. Then I will request you to please stand as we pray together. Father, I have had you again this day in this conference, and I want to walk with you unto all places. I want to walk with you with a single eye. I want to keep my ears glued only to the leading of your spirit. Help me to be so clear-minded in all I am engaged with henceforth, in Jesus' name. I will trust in your grace to keep me through.